and welcome to the Dynamic Duel Podcast, a weekly show where we review superhero films and debate the superiority between Marvel and DC by comparing their characters in stat-based battle simulations. I'm Marvelous Joe.
And I'm his twin brother, Johnny DC.
And in this episode, we are going to find out who'd win in a fight between Starro the Conqueror, you know, the villain from the recent Suicide Squad movie, versus Fin Fang Foom, who's Marvel's most prominent kaiju character. He's a giant dragon. We thought maybe he was going to show up in the Shang-Chi film. He wasn't quite there. That was the Great Protector Dragon. But Fin Fang Foom does have some dealings with the character of the Mandarin and Shang-Chi himself, which we'll get into when we learn all about these characters' histories later on this episode.
Yeah, I've been looking forward to this matchup for a while. This is going to be fun finding out who's going to win.
Before that, we're going to go over the comic book movie news to have come out in the past week, which only included the Injustice official trailer.
Yeah, there were some video game announcements for Marvel, but neither Joseph nor I own a PlayStation 5, so we aren't really qualified to talk about them.
Yeah, I'm excited to see what they're like, though. You know, there's a Spider-Man game and a new Wolverine game, Guardians of the Galaxy. Looks pretty cool. Me, I'm still playing Fortnite. If you guys play Fortnite, you should squad up with Jonathan and I. I'm Marvelous Joe on there. He's Johnny-DC, and we have a creator code, which is Duel, D-U-E-L, so check that out.
But as always, we list our segment times in our episode description, so feel free to check out the show notes if you want to skip ahead to a particular part of the episode.
Just a reminder, guys, that only the most recent four episodes are available to the listening public. If you want access to over 200 episodes of archived content of this podcast, including our Batman vs. Superman review,
our Shazam vs. Black Bolt duel episode,
our Justice League Throne of Atlantis review,
Beast Boy vs. Beast,
our New Mutants review,
or Kilowog vs. Beta Ray Bill, be sure to subscribe to this podcast on Spotify or Patreon, both of which will provide you with an RSS feed to use in your podcast app.
On Patreon, you also get bonus content, including bonus episodes every month, access to our Discord server, and more. It's only $2 a month to subscribe on Spotify or Patreon, and you can do so by visiting dynamicduel.com/subscribe, which is linked in our show notes. We want to give a big shout out to our newest patrons, Ryan McMullen, and our two newest executive producers of this podcast, Dustin Balcom and Salvador Hernandez Contreras Jr.
You guys are awesome. Thank you so much for supporting this show.
But with that out of the way,
quick to the No Prize. A No Prize is an award that Marvel used to give out up until the 90s to fans. Our version, the Dynamic Duel No Prize, is a digital award that we post on social media that I personally draw for those who we feel gave the best answer to our question of the week. Last week's question tied into the reveal that James Wan and Jason Momoa gave of Aquaman's new stealth suit for the upcoming Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom film.
Right, and we asked, what is your favorite alternate version of a live-action superhero costume from a film, and why?
I honestly thought we were going to get a lot more answers for this. There are a lot of cool alternate costumes.
But we did get a few great answers. We'd like to run down our list of honorable mentions, as well as the no prize winner. Our first honorable mention goes to Michael Haggerty, who said,
"Hello, boys. Michael Haggerty here. My favorite alternate costume has to be Chris O'Donnell's, the only Robin with a built-in life alert. Originally, he was wearing his acrobat suit from when his parents were killed by Two-Face. Oops, spoilers! To, Alfred building him that sexy leather piece with the nice colors and the nipples and everything else. And you really got to wonder how Alfred got those measurements. Must have been while he was doing watch foo! Watcha!"
You know, I've never really thought about it, but Alfred is kind of one freaky dude, making all those leather BDSM costumes.
Yeah, and for his niece in the next movie.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's creepy. It's like, oh, I have a costume for you. Oh, do you need to, like,
my cup size?
Yeah, do you need my measurements? He's like, oh, no, I can tell just by looking.
I mean, that's either the mark of a pervert or an exceptionally fine tailor.
Or both. Not mutually exclusive, you know?
I personally think that Robin's costume was better in Batman Forever than in Batman and Robin.
I agree. In Batman and Robin, it was kind of steering a little bit more towards Nightwing, which I love Nightwing's costume. But there is something to be said for, like, the shiny burgundy maroon he had going on in Batman Forever.
Yeah.
It was cool. It was, like, the first time Robin ever looked cool.
Yeah, that might be true.
Our next honorable mention goes to Miggy Matangian, who said,
"Hey guys, it's Miggy. And even though I don't really like Tom Holland as Spider-Man, my favorite live-action, like, alternate suit would have to be his homemade suit, because it never made sense to me that Toby and Andrew would be able to make those nice suits from home."
Maybe Alfred made them for them.
What? Those are some pretty fancy suits for them to be sewing in their own house.
Right, right. Especially with the materials they use, especially Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man outfit with like the detailed intricate webbing that's laid over it. That is exceptionally difficult craftsmanship to do at home by hand.
Yeah. I mean, if the whole Spider-Man thing doesn't work out, he could always get a job as like a fashion designer.
Right, exactly. Whereas Tom Holland, you know, it was pretty much a hoodie with sweatpants and like a red ski mask with goggles. You know, it made sense for the character. And you know what? Spider-Man's suit looks kind of cool just stripped down like that. I was a fan, for sure, of the suit from Homecoming.
It wasn't bad. Our final honorable mention goes to Brandon Estergaard, who said,
"Hey guys, I have to give this one to Sinestro's Yellow Lantern suit from the Green Lantern movie. Just because, you know, regardless of how you felt about the film, it still made you want a sequel. And seeing Mark Strong as Sinestro in the Yellow Lantern suit, freaking iconic, man."
Was there anything better than Sinestro's yellow suit in that 2011 Green Lantern movie?
That pretty much was the best thing about the movie. You know, especially because we never got the sequel, you know? At least we got this brief tease because we could have not gotten it, honestly.
Right.
We could have never seen Mark Strong in the yellow suit.
Yeah.
And that would have been tragic.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I'm glad we got to see it.
So big thanks to everyone who answered, especially Evan Tomke, who took the time to visit the website, hit the record button, and leave his response. But the winner of this week's No Prize goes to Dustin Balcom, who said,
"Hey, Dynamic Duel, Dustin Balcom here, and my favorite alternate costume would probably be the Harley Quinn one from the James Gunn Suicide Squad, that black and red suit that she's wearing, especially at the beginning of the movie. I think that that's the best, like, costume change I've seen from a movie, like, improving upon the previous, because the first Prey one, terrible, and the first Suicide Squad one is okay. But this one takes
cake." Yeah, the outfit was really cool when she first landed on the Corto Maltese Island. It was red and black, acrobatic, but functional.
Yeah, I'm really kind of sad we didn't get to see more of it in the movie. It was really just that scene and, you know, her talking on the helicopter before that.
Yeah, and then, of course, in the red and black dress after that.
But compared to the previous movies that she was in, I agree with Dustin Balcom. It was absolutely the best version of the Harley Quinn suit from the comics and the video games that we love in this film.
Yeah, honestly, I kind of like this first outfit from the Suicide Squad movie more than her traditional Harlequin jester outfit, which I think would kind of appear as silly next to the other members of the Suicide Squad.
Yeah, maybe. I think there might be one way to pull it off if you just get a really good designer on it. We did get to see that jester outfit for like 5 seconds in the first Suicide Squad film directed by David Ayer. Like the whole black and red leather biker outfit with the black and red hair was perfect in the Suicide Squad. James Gunn obviously is a fan of the character from the comics. But honestly, guys, I'm surprised no one said like armored Batman from BVS or Silver Centurion from Iron Man 2.
Yeah, there were a lot of great options to choose from for sure. But yeah, congrats again to Dustin Balcom for winning this week's No Prize. If you, the listener, want a shot at winning your own No Prize, stay tuned to later on this episode when we'll be asking another question of the week. And now that that's done, on to the news.
Okay, so an animated film based on the NetherRealm Studios video game Injustice will be coming out this October, and we got our first look at the trailer for this film just this past week.
Yeah, I'm not too familiar with the Injustice story. Literally, this trailer is my first exposure to it, and I gotta say, it looks incredible.
Really?
Yes. Basically, it's Superman's entire world getting shattered by the Joker, and he's gonna do some shit to the Joker, I already know it. And he and Batman are going to have like an ethical debate, and it's going to be the debate that I've always wanted them to have. To me, it seems like it's going to be DC's Civil War.
It's pretty close to that, I would say. Yeah, it's pretty close.
Now, typically, I'm not a fan of Dark Superman. I never think that Superman would ever take the side of we should kill people who kill other people.
Mm-hmm.
But to see it play out in this way, and especially for Superman to straight up confront Batman and be like, dude, why would anyone let the Joker live this long? Seems like a really compelling story that to me has never been told.
It is a really compelling story. You know, I have had the debate of what would it take for Batman to kill the Joker how many times?
Yeah.
This story gets really dark really fast. I'm glad you really liked this trailer. I honestly didn't really care for it.
Well, you've read the comics, so you probably know what's being left out.
And there's a ton of it. You know, it's a very simple setup for the story. That said, the video game was made by the same creators as Mortal Kombat. This is a very, like, violent, very hardcore story, and we didn't get a sense of that at all. I mean, this movie is rated R.
Yeah, for bloody violence.
Exactly. They should have given us some hint of that. Honestly, I think if this trailer was just like the opening scene to the comic or the video game, where Superman straight up, like, shoves his arm through the Joker, just brutally killing him.
Hell yeah.
That would have been a much better sell. To me, this is like, kids will see this and be like, oh, I want to watch the next Justice League movie. It's like, no, dude, this is not for you. The trailer starts off with Joker and Harley Quinn ambushing Lois Lane. Although I had to do a double take, I didn't realize that it was Lois Lane right away because of the hair color.
Yeah, she has red hair, right?
Yeah, it's definitely more of like an Amy Adams approach to Lois Lane. I thought it was like Iris West at first or something like that, or Barbara Gordon. But no, after that we see like the superhero community freaking out because Lois is in trouble. A nuclear bomb goes off and Green Lantern protects everyone from it. All of this stuff is very interesting setup, and I guess it does tease what the story sort of is. I'm on the same boat with you in terms of like the whole debate between Batman and Superman. To me, that's always been a really interesting aspect of the storyline. So I can't wait to see more of that. As far as the voice cast goes, Justin Hartley does the voice of Superman, and I think it skews a little bit younger. I would have liked to hear a more mature voice, I think, for this mature story. But Anson Mount, I think, does a great job as Batman.
He makes a much better Batman than he does Black Bolt from the Inhumans ABC television series.
I mean, we never got to hear him in that role. So well,
we did hear him say goodbye, brother, at the end of that series.
Oh, I never finished that series. Luckily.
Yeah, so. Luckily for you, yeah.
Gillian Jacobs from Community is going to be Harley Quinn, and Harley Quinn has a great arc in the Injustice storyline, so that's another thing I'm looking forward to. I think Gillian Jacobs will nail that.
What do you think of the art style?
Not a big fan of the Joker mullet. The character design really isn't that great, but honestly, the character design from the initial video game, I never really cared too much for.
It was like over-designed, right?
Yeah. And you could clearly see that here with like, you know, Green Lantern and Batman, Wonder Woman's pants. It is what it is. But it looks like there's going to be a pretty cool cast of characters in this film. You know, everyone's going to be in here from Mr. Terrific to Plastic Man to Mirror Master and Shazam. Ra's al Ghul. It's going to be pretty cool.
And it doesn't come out too far from now.
Right. It's going to be available on Tuesday, October 19th on Blu-ray and digital. So everyone will get access to it at the same time, essentially. If you're unfamiliar with the Injustice storyline, don't, like, research it. You don't want to spoil it for yourself. It's a really cool story. But that brings us to our question of the week. What Marvel or DC video game story would you like to see be adapted into a movie, and why?
Yeah, live action or animated movie, doesn't matter. Basically, what's your favorite video game story from Marvel or DC? Record your answer at dynamicduel.com by clicking on the red microphone button in the bottom right-hand corner, which will prompt you to leave us a voicemail. Your message can be up to 30 seconds long, and don't forget to leave your name in case we include you on the podcast. We'll pick our favorite answer and draw that person a Dynamic Duel No Prize that we'll post to social media. Be sure to answer before September 18th. But that does it for the news for this episode. Guys, did you know that this Saturday, September 18th, is officially Batman Day? All around the world, people will be celebrating the Caped Crusader with the new Batman podcast coming out, the new Batman restaurant in London.
But the most important way to celebrate Batman Day is by wearing some eye-catching fashion gear worthy of Batman himself from Cufflinks.com, who is sponsoring this episode. They were generous enough to send me one of their black and gold Batman tie clips, and good lord, is it a beaut.
It is especially sharp looking. Like, not in the dangerous sense.
Yeah, not like sharp like a batarang.
Right, sharp as in stylish with its black and gold plating.
It looks like a Batman gadget, right? And I feel like Batman when I wear it with my DC Comics tie. Like, walking around town just ready to beat down whatever crime I see.
Like, oh, did you not know this is my city? Did you not see the tie clip?
I'm Batman, and I'm fabulous.
And you listeners can look equally fabulous and save 15% off any purchase when you buy from cufflinks.com this month and use the code DUEL, that's D-U-E-L, at checkout.
And don't forget, we're giving away a Batman medallion symbol charcoal silk men's tie to one lucky listener who visits dynamicduel.com/Batman. chooses what they think is the coolest Batman product they have, then shares it on Twitter using the Twitter share button on the product page. Just be sure to @cufflinks.com and @dynamic_duel, and we will put your name in the running. You have until the end of Batman Day, September 18th, to participate, and we'll announce the tie winner in our next episode.
Yeah, guys, don't pass this opportunity up. You've got a chance here to win a free Batman tie for only the cost of a mere tweet. It's literally the easiest thing you could do.
Yeah, do it for Batman.
You can get more information about this in our show notes. But let's go ahead and get into the main event of this episode, where we find out who would win in a fight between the Justice League villain, Starro the Conqueror, and the Marvel villain, slash hero, he's a dragon, Fin Fang Foom. Alright, Starro the Conqueror versus Fin Fang Foom. We got a giant starfish against a giant dragon. It's a kaiju battle, like in the sense of King Kong versus Godzilla, or Godzilla versus King Ghidorah, or Godzilla versus Mechagodzilla. It's gonna be awesome. The one thing that I regret about this matchup is that since none of these duels take place in an environment, we're not going to be speculating about these guys like destroying a city in the midst of their battle.
All right, so much collateral damage. Starro has always been like one of my favorite Justice League villains. The guy is really creepy in a way that like an alien facehugger is creepy. So I've been looking forward to doing a match with him for a while. And when we were deciding, you know, who to pit him against, because we knew we wanted to do some kind of tie-in duel for the Suicide Squad, why not Fin Fang Foom?
Yeah, he's a kaiju and he's not creepy. He's actually quite eloquent and well-spoken, just a legendary creature. We'll learn all about both of these characters shortly. If you've never listened to one of our duel episodes before, the way we determine a winner between these two characters is by running 1,000 Monte Carlo simulations using their statistics. Now, a Monte Carlo simulation is a probabilistic model used to determine outcomes through random sampling.
In our case, it randomizes statistics along a normal distribution, which is a bell curve, as a way to simulate the many variables that can occur during battle. The stat parameters we use are based on the official Marvel power grid, and we use that criteria to extrapolate the DC character stats. We've included some additional stat categories of our own, such as range, damage potential, versatility, and perception, in order to create a more complete and robust simulation.
Running these 1,000 simulations gives us a percentage of wins for each character, and we declare the one with the higher percentage to be the ultimate victor, considering that they're more likely to win any given battle. No character ever wins 100% of the time. Comics have shown that there's always a way for Batman to defeat Superman, and we feel our method falls in line with the precedents that have been established in the comic book stories.
And we use this method because it was the least subjective, most unbiased way to determine who would win. Of course, we're both heavily biased toward our respective allegiances, and instead of debating these matches forever, we just let the math decide for us. So there's no fan votes here, and no relying on just feats.
Before we run the simulations, though, we like to break down each character's histories and abilities before improvising a scenario on how we imagine one of the 1,000 simulations we run would play out beat for beat. And I think it's your turn to go first this episode with the DC character, so yeah. Tell us all about Starro the Conqueror.
Alright, so the term Starro does not refer to a singular villain, but rather an entire alien race of telepathic star-shaped parasites. Now, these parasites, initially unintelligent predators, came from a planet known as an O-world, or a zero world, an anomaly that disregards the laws of space-time and usually dies out pretty quick. But one planet managed to mature, and from this planet came the first Starros. Starros operated in a hive-type society in which a massive mother star queen, also known as a star conqueror, would land on a planet and asexually produce smaller star spores, or probes, that would infect and enslave the planet's entire population, turning them into mindless drones in order to build a nest and gather resources to prepare for the birth of a new mother star queen, who would grow and leave the planet in search of a new planet to conquer, where it would lay new mother star eggs and then die. Eventually, a mother star landed on a planet named Hitori, which was the home to a primitive telepathic race of humanoids. When the Starro spores infected everyone on the planet, the Hatorians were still able to communicate telepathically despite the spores enslaving and controlling them via their nervous systems. One by one, the Hatori race died, their bodies worked to death, though their minds lived on in a communal mind link, full of panic, rage, and fear. Time passed, and the last two surviving Hatorians were brothers named Andres and Kobe. Because Andres was older and stronger, he bore the brunt of their race's anger and turmoil, allowing him to psychically overcome the Starro's control over him. With his freedom, Andres attempted to destroy the Mother Star's eggs, but one of the tiny Mother Stars hatched early, and, in an attempt to save its life, attached to Andres' younger brother, Kobe, controlling him into killing Andres. As the first being in existence to have a Mother Star attached to it, and now as the bearer of the entire psychic energy of his planet, Kobe took telepathic control over the Mother Star, giving him command of the entire Starro Hive. Vowing to use the Starros to bring order to the chaos that was his existence, Kobe, now going by the name Starro himself, traveled across the cosmos, enslaving not only other Mother Star colonies, but entire planets and galaxies, getting strength for each mind brought under his control. As 9 galaxies and trillions of minds came under his complete rule, Kobe Starro sent out Mother Stars across the universe to find planets to conquer. One of these Mother Stars eventually discovered Earth, and it was the very first foe that the Justice League of America fought against together as a team. You can learn more about the Justice League in our Justice League vs. Avengers episode. Now, after absorbing energy from an atomic bomb, gaining the intelligence of a consortium of scientists, and enslaving an entire town of Happy Harbor, Starro was defeated by the League after they discovered they could dissolve it like salt on a snail using a gardening chemical known as quicklime. A small portion of Starro survived in the sea, however, and after a young boy fished it out of the water, Starro regenerated itself, spawning millions of spores and enslaving all of New York City, along with League members Superman, Wonder Woman, Green Lantern, and Firestorm. The rest of the League deduced that Starro was susceptible to freezing temperatures and froze it solid, disabling all of its spores and freeing the citizens of New York. Imprisoned on Earth, Starro eventually convinced the Justice League Europe team that it was dying and wished to return to space. It was a trick that allowed Starro to take control of Western Europe before being frozen once more and ultimately defeated. A new, small Starro probe eventually arrived on Earth and took control of the town of Blue Valley, as well as the Flash. Batman was able to freeze this Starro and shrunk it down to store it within a jar on the Justice League's moon base headquarters, only for a dozen new Mother Stars to come soon after, enslaving a majority of the planet's population. With the help of the Dream Lord, Sandman, the Justice League were able to combat Starro within the psychic dream realm. After the Starros were defeated, Sandman kept them in a small fishbowl within his domain. A different Mother Star in another galaxy was drafted into the Sinestro Corps, which you can learn more about in our Sinestro vs. Magneto episode. Wielding 5 rings, Starro arrived on Earth and enslaved most of Earth's villains, and it took the combined might of the Teen Titans and a future version of themselves to defeat the Conqueror. By this point, Kobe Starro had deemed Earth's heroes a worthy challenge and made his way toward our galaxy, though his journey was cut short by the Blackest Night event within an area of space run by Legion, or the Licensed Extragovernmental Interstellar Operatives Network, a commercial governmental agency run by Vril Drox II, aka Brainiac 2, a Kaluan genius not to be confused with his father, the original Brainiac, who you can learn more about in our Brainiac vs. Ultron duel episode. With the help of Adam Strange, Captain Comet, Starfire, Lobo, and the Omega Men, Brainiac 2 was able to stop Kobe Starro from ever reaching Earth. Post-Flashpoint, the starfish version of Starro had much more personality. During the Dark Knight's Metal event, in which the Dark Multiverse invaded the Prime DC Universe, Starro sided with the Thanagarian tyrant Onimar Sin, threatening to blow up the Earth should it ever fall to the Dark Knights, who were evil, superpowered versions of Bruce Wayne from universes that should have been destroyed, but weren't. Starro and Sin's plan backfired, however, and the Dark Knights managed to drag Earth into the Dark Multiverse, with the rest of the universe following. The Justice League eventually defeated the Dark Knights, pulling the Earth out of the Dark Multiverse, but cracking the source wall at the edge of the universe in the process. A new threat emerged from this crack, the Omega Titans, which threatened to destroy all intelligent life in the universe. Brainiac assembled various heroes and villains, including Starro, into teams to stop the Omega Titans. During Starro's team's mission, Martian Manhunter convinced Starro to help the team save countless worlds that Brainiac had shrunk in order to protect them from the Omega Titans, and Starro sacrificed itself, attempting to enslave one of those Titans. Batman saved a small fragment of the Starro, however, which grew into a tiny version named Jarro, who developed its own consciousness and believed Batman to be his father. It was revealed, however, that the Legion of Doom possessed a larger fragment of the original Starro that was growing into a Mother Star. And that's Starro's history. Now, Starro's primary ability is telepathy, which it gained from Kobe. It's also capable of spawning smaller parasitic spores. Starro can take physical and telepathic control over a planetary population's worth of hosts via spores or mere proximity. Typically, Starro grows in size as it absorbs more and more psychic energy, and it possesses a hive mind with all other Starros across the universe. Its spores can be microscopic, and mother stars can grow as large as planetary oceans. The larger it grows, the more control it has over its own gravity. It has strength relative to its size, has extremely durable skin, and it's capable of regenerating entirely, even from a small fragment. It's also capable of absorbing, storing, and emitting various types of energy from its limbs or its eyeball. And that's Starro.
Oh, it can project energy?
Yeah.
Did you say that these spores can be microscopic in size?
Yes.
That's horrifying.
That is. Like, that is.
You're breathing in a bunch of Starro.
It's like COVID. All of a sudden, you can't taste or smell anything.
Ugh.
All of a sudden, like, your body's moving in a way you don't want it to.
Oh, God.
And you're thinking Starro thoughts. Yeah.
Wear masks, people. Get vaccinated. Can Starro control the size of these spores that it emits?
Yeah, it can.
Now, Starro's background is actually less cohesive than I thought it was going to be.
He hasn't made too many appearances since his inception, and when he does, he doesn't have much of a character. It was really Scott Snyder who gave Starro character.
Okay.
So
I noticed as you were putting together, like, the Frankenstein backstory and the Black Orchid backstory, and now probably this one, it seems like you are actually giving people the most comprehensive history of these characters that actually exist out there on the internet.
Dude, thank you. That is probably true. I've been reading a ton of comics for some of these more obscure characters, so I think they're pretty comprehensive, yeah.
I think I may also have the most comprehensive backstory on Fin Fang Foom out there. I don't know, but I did enjoy reading a lot of comics with him. Let me tell you all about Marvel's premier dragon. Fin Fang Foom was born over 1,000 years ago on the planet Maklu 4 as part of a race of dragon-like creatures. They were a peaceful species, gifted with advanced technology. However, one day, a small group of young Makluans left their world in a plot to conquer another planet. Fin Fang Foom was the navigator of this rebel ship and charted a course to planet Earth, where the group landed in ancient mainland China. The crew used their natural shape-shifting powers to disguise themselves as normal humans in order to study humanity and develop their attack plan. Fin, however, stayed back with the ship near the Valley of Spirits, in what would become known as the Valley of the Sleeping Dragon. He was placed into suspended hibernation using a special herb to be awakened as backup if the rest of the Makluans were compromised while undercover. At some point in the 8th century, a small village stumbled upon Finn's... I'm going to call him Fin. Fin Fang Foom.
Okay.
They stumbled upon Fin's resting place when he awoke and terrorized them, falling into Chinese legend as the Sleeping Dragon. He fell back asleep, and the villagers began guarding the entrance to his lair so as not to disturb him again. Later in the 17th century, he awoke and attacked the city of Tianjin, but was stopped by the father of the hero Shang-Chi, Zhengzu, and his Five Weapon Society. You can learn more about him in our Lady Shiva vs. Shang-Chi duel episode. In the 1960s, a teenager named Chan Lu Chao stumbled upon ancient manuscripts detailing the location of the Sleeping Dragon. With his homeland being terrorized by rising communist Chinese forces, Chan set out to see if the legend was true. He found and awoke Fin Fang Foom, then taunted and led the giant dragon to the communist concentration camps, which Finn decimated. Chan then led the dragon back to his valley, where he slept again. At one point, Fin Fang Foom's body was possessed by a demon called An Tanu, and he began attacking New York City on behalf of an evil cult that had summoned the demon. Chan Lu Chao, who at this point was a middle-aged doctor, assisted a team called the Legion of Night in battling against the evil cult and exorcising the demon from Fin Fang Foom's body and from Earth's reality. Confused, Finn left New York City and traveled back to the Valley of the Sleeping Dragon. A short time later, though, an elder of the universe known as the Collector abducted Finn and a variety of other monsters from Earth and imprisoned them in his collection. A villain called the Mole Man invaded the Collector's museum and freed all the monsters, who came back down to Earth to cause chaos around the globe. Eventually, Fin Fang Foom and the others were rounded up by the Fantastic Four, who exiled them to a remote island in the Pacific Ocean called Monster Isle. It wasn't long before Finn was discovered by an evil scientist named Dr. Vault, who attempted to mentally control the dragon into attacking a behemoth made of stone known as It, the Living Colossus. Finn instead resisted the mind control and teamed up with the Living Colossus to fend off an alien attack, saving Earth for his own kind to conquer. Dr. Vault then strengthened his influence over Finn and caused him to attack the stone giant with the dragon using martial arts to ensure his victory. Shaking off Dr. Vault's influence, Fin Fang Foom traveled back to his valley to hibernate once more. Eventually, a man who would later be known as the Mandarin discovered the McLuhan starship and stole the vessel's power sources that he would don as rings on his hands. You can learn more about the Mandarin in our duel episode where we pit him against Abracadabra. He used the rings and controlled Fin Fang Foom into conquering one-third of China. At this point, the other McLuhan dragons decided to begin their worldwide invasion and shed their human guises. The dragons terrorized Southeast Asia until Iron Man came in and merged his armor's tech with the Mandarin's rings to create an explosion that decimated both Fin Fang Foom and his McLuhan brethren.
Aww.
Though Finn was destroyed, his spirit was not, and it bonded itself with a small dragon statue in a New York City curio shop. A boy named Billy Yuan purchased the statue, and Fin Fang Foom possessed his body, using him as a conduit to summon thousands of lizards from the sewers that merged and morphed into a new dragon body that Fin Fang Foom now possessed.
That's crazy!
He fought the Avengers and was defeated and relocated to Monster Isle. Weary of battle, Fin Fang Foom shapeshifted into a human form like his previous allies and entered human society with the help of Mr. Fantastic of the Fantastic Four. He became a Buddhist and, after discovering a love of food and cooking, became the head chef of a Chinese restaurant in the Baxter Building in New York.
Wow.
He reluctantly helped Doctor Strange's assistant Wong in defeating a group of Hydra agents. And later, Fin retook his monster form and fought alongside other giant Monster Isle residents Gugam, Gorgilla, and Electro, with a K, against Timbu Ba, the size-changing warlord from the Microverse. Fin and his fellow monsters teamed up again to fend off an invasion of alien monsters known as Leviathans. And for a short period of time, Fin Fang Foom was celebrated as a hero. And that's his backstory. Powers-wise, Fin Fang Foom has the physiology of his McLuhan alien race, meaning he is incredibly strong, able to lift vastly more than 100 tons. He's considerably durable, able to tank all but the strongest of attacks, and has a regenerative healing factor, though extensive injuries require hibernation to recover from. If he is destroyed, his spirit is eternal and can inhabit other beings that he can reform into his own body. He can alter his size and shapeshift, and can communicate telepathically as his species naturally does. He does have some psychic resistance, his dragon wings allow him to fly at supersonic speeds, and he can spew corrosive acid mist from his mouth that resembles fire with its luminescence that can burn through nearly anything.
Why isn't it just fire?
I don't know, it's not. It's acid, though.
Interesting. Is it, like, green?
No, it's orange.
The fuck?
Yeah. He's highly intelligent, coming from an advanced alien race, and is a proven spacecraft navigator and eloquent speaker. Fin Fang Foom is also a master of McLuhan martial arts. And that's his backstory.
I guess I really didn't touch on Starro's intelligence. The dude's really smart. He literally has the intelligence of, like, so many alien hosts from across the universe.
None of them as advanced as McLuhan's, I would assume.
You would assume incorrectly there, my friend.
You don't know.
You don't know either!
But now that we got their backstories out of the way, let's speculate on how one of the 1,000 simulated matches between Starro and Fin Fang Foom will go. The winner is determined by simulations, not the speculation, but it's fun to imagine how this fight could play out.
We don't set any rules for this match, other than the characters don't know anything about each other going in, except that the other character is a threat that needs to be put down. And we say that they start off about 50 meters apart in an environment that has no bearing on the match itself, because we don't take stats for the environment.
Plus, certain characters have advantages in some environments over others, and we want these characters to win on their own merit. So let's get into it. Fin Fang Foom and Starro meet on the battlefield. Who goes first?
I'm going to say that Starro goes off first.
Okay.
And just to be clear, like, this is a mother star Starro. It's like the size of a skyscraper.
All right, so is Fin Fang Foom, though.
All right.
Also like the size of a skyscraper.
Okay, so Starro's going to start off by squirting out like a legion of Starro spores, all of whom float toward Finn.
Starro squirts these out?
Yeah.
Gross. But how big are these spores? Like, what happens if they're not big enough to cover Fin Fang Foom's face?
They don't need to be attached to someone's face to control them. Like, a small one the size of a half dollar can control a human, like, well attached anywhere.
Really?
Yeah. And again, like, for the larger Starros, anything in proximity can fall under their psychic control.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so if these spores can attach anywhere, basically Fin Fang Foom can't let any of them touch him.
Right.
So he sees this Starro spore army flying toward him, and with a mighty roar, Fin Fang Foom flaps his wings and flies up into the air, just letting these Starro spores chase him, basically.
He's running away?
He has a plan, okay?
All right.
So he's going to lead the Starros up and around, and he's going to dive into the ground, burrowing and digging a long horizontal tunnel. And as the spores like gather in the tunnel, Fin Fang Foom is going to slash at the ceiling and just create this giant cave-in that buries all of the spores.
Oh, nice. That was a good one. Okay, but Starro, you know, he's going to be carefully watching to see, like, where Fin Fang Foom will appear, all right? So as Fin, like, erupts from the ground nearby, Starro blasts him with these atomic lasers that come from the tips of his tentacles.
So he can shoot lasers from his tentacles and from his eye?
Yeah, he can shoot, like, six at once, which is what he does.
But when Fin Fang Foom comes out of the ground, like a freaking volcano, he's going to be like twisting, swirling, and dodging all of these laser blasts like a giant ribbon. And he's going to unleash this colossal fireball or acid ball or whatever that's just going to hit one of Starro's limbs and corrode it, just like Polka Dot Man did in the Suicide Squad movie.
All right, okay, so one of Starro's limbs is gone, but it's okay. Starro regenerates, all right? So it's panicked, though, okay? So Starro's going to launch itself toward this dragon and just wrap all four of its tentacles around him, like binding his limbs and wrestling him into submission, okay? So with Fin now under Starro's control, Starro relaxes his grip a little, you know, freeing up Finn's arms, and he's going to force the dragon to slash at his own body.
Whoa.
While Starro spawns a couple more Starros that grow with the might of Finn's psychic energy, because I'm sure he has, you know, ample psychic energy, considering he's semi-psychic himself.
True that, true that. Okay, so there's three giant Starros now?
Well, one giant Starro, and two of them are growing.
Okay, but like Fin Fang Foom, he has psychic defenses. He's not so easily controlled for that long. So yeah, he's slashing at himself, but before long, he comes out of Starro's influence, and he's gonna grab the starfish and tear off another of its limbs with his teeth. Then he's just gonna judo throw Starro into the ground and then like body slam it, smashing it in like this massive earthquake, turning the starfish into just this big pile of purple goo.
What? Like, Starro's pretty durable.
I'm pretty sure Starro's durable, but also squishy, you know?
Okay, so the mother star is dead, but these two other smaller Starros that were created earlier, they're just gonna like fly into Fin Fang Foom's back and just begin lasering off his wings and feeding on his psychic energy.
Oh. But Fin Fang Foom's a dragon. He's like a serpent. He's agile. He's going to bend around. He's going to snatch these two Starros off of him. And holding them in his hands in front of him, he's just going to unleash this giant acid blast that reduces them to jelly.
But surprise, with all of the psychic energy that the young Starros were collecting, that sped up the regeneration process of the Mother Star limb that Fin Fang Foom ripped off earlier, creating a new Mother Star. And this thing's pissed.
So the Mother Star Starro grew from this one ripped off limb.
Yeah, the tentacle, yeah. So this new Starro, it's just gonna incinerate Fin Fang Foom's body with like this massive atomic beam from its eye. This thing's huge.
Okay, but Fin Fang Foom sees it coming. He dodges this atomic blast by shape-shifting into the size about like the size of an alligator or something.
He dodges a big blast by transforming into something small?
Yeah, smaller things can dodge things easier. So he does that.
Okay.
And then he transforms his body into one of the Starro spores. Okay, so he looks like Starro himself, which confuses the Mother Star Starro.
I mean, not really. Starros have a hive mind, so like Starro would know right away that Finn was a fake.
No, he wouldn't, because Fin Fang Foom can communicate telepathically. So he's like, "Well, looks like we got him. Yay!"
Except Starro would be like, "Wait, we didn't think that." And then it's just gonna like hurl several spores like ninja stars that just like, smack right into the smaller Fin Fang Foom disguised, and they just smother him and kill him.
Okay, well that ruse didn't work. And yeah, sure, they kill him. Whatever, big deal. Fin Fang Foom dies, but his spirit possesses the Mother Star. Okay, so now he's in control of the Mother Star, and he's just gonna transform that beast into his own large dragon body. So he's back.
Okay.
And he sees the two remaining Starros that were thrown at him, and he's just gonna freaking decimate them with this flying dragon kick. Just launching across the field, whap whap, and turning them into like bugs on a windshield. Hiya!
That's ridiculous.
It's not ridiculous. Fin Fang Foom knows martial arts.
Clearly, this was like all like a fantasy illusion cast by Starro within Fin Fang Foom's mind.
What? You
know, like back from when Starro first wrapped around him. Like Finn has been comatose this whole time, sleeping because that's what he's good at, you know. and Starro, he's just like done toying with him, and he just finally shuts down his mind completely, making Starro the winner of this match.
No, man. Fin Fang Foom has psychic defenses. He has a strong mind. He would see right through this illusion, if it was an illusion, which it was not an illusion, and Fin Fang Foom dragon kicked the starfish to death.
Dude, Starro is like one of the most powerful psychic beings in the universe. No one's that powerful.
Fin Fang Foom is.
No one.
Well, let's settle this like men by taking it to the numbers. Either most of this battle was an illusion and Starro just shuts down Fin Fang Foom's mind, which I think is the lame way to go, or you have a dragon doing a dragon kick, which I think is the better way to go, honestly. Let's input the stats, run the simulations, and come back with a winner.
This honestly is like one of my favorite matches that we've ever done. These are just cool characters. I love thinking of ways in which they can fight.
Yeah, kaijus themselves are pretty cool.
They're cool and powerful, right? When it came to the stats, both of them were maxed out in a few categories, like strength. You really don't get stronger than kaijus.
Yeah, damage level. These guys could destroy cities on a whim.
They were also both really durable, although we gave the slight edge to Starro because he could regenerate faster.
Yeah, they both can take massive hits from like Superman to Thor, but you're right. When they get really hurt, Fin Fang Foom has to go into hibernation, whereas Starro doesn't.
All he needs is, you know, more psychic energy.
Yeah.
There were a few categories where they differed pretty heavily, though. Like, fighting skill.
Oh, yeah. Fin Fang Foom just totally annihilated Starro in fighting skill.
Which like, is ridiculous.
Like, Starro may know a lot of fighting styles, but the only thing you're going to see this fat-ass starfish do is just, like, throw some slaps, you know?
He really doesn't have a fighting body. I mean, you could argue that Jaro is actually a pretty good fighter, but this isn't Jaro. This is Starro.
Yeah.
And Starro is better when it came to perception. Not only because he's a telepath, but also because he has a hive mind.
Right, and he could perceive things through all of his spores.
Happening, like, on another side of the universe going on at the same time. So, that's pretty cool.
We also said that Starro was a little bit more intelligent than Fin Fang Foom. Yes, Fin Fang Foom is from an advanced race. Yes, he's lived for thousands of years and knows a lot of stuff. But again, with Starro's hive mind, he has the accumulated knowledge of the trillions of beings that have been assimilated.
And his hive mind race has lived for, you know, millions if not billions of years.
Yeah. We did give Fin Fang Foom the edge in speed, though, since it was stated that he can fly at supersonic speeds, whereas Starro is more of a floater.
That's
like
fair.
A turd in a toilet bowl.
In the wind.
So, yeah. I think Fin Fang Foom would be able to fly circles around Starro.
He doesn't need to move that fast because, you know, not only is he kind of omnipresent, but his, you know, atomic laser beams make him a pretty solid ranged fighter.
And so is Fin Fang Foom with his acid blasts and his concussive blasts. And finally, when it came to evasiveness, you know, they're both giants. They're easy to hit.
Right. You know? I mean, Fin Fang Foom does have the ability to transform, so he could kind of disguise himself. But one thing I forgot to mention earlier is that Starro can change his color like an octopus, like a squid. So he has camouflage as well. So they were even there.
So with all that said, it seems like this is going to be a pretty close match.
Yeah. Who do you think came out on top?
Fin Fang Foom, because he's a fucking dragon. And our Instagram followers agree with me, with 55% of them saying that Fin Fang Foom is going to take this whole thing.
And I really don't get that, because Starro was so cool in the Suicide Squad.
He was not cooler than the Great Protector in Shang-Chi.
But that wasn't even Fin Fang Foom.
It was pretty close, you know, he's a wise old dragon, you know?
That's dumb. Well, I've got the results right here. Let's see if you guys were correct. The winner of the matchup between Starro and Fin Fang Foom is motherfucking Starro!
What? No! Yep. Read that again. Read it again, obviously.
It says, motherfucking Starro!
No way!
But barely.
Okay.
He won 53.1% of the 1,000 matches, or 531 wins, compared to Fin Fang Foom's 46.9.
God damn it. That's so close. Couldn't it have been the other way around?
Nah, sorry. It came down to perception and intellect. Starro is just so much more of a psychic presence and behemoth.
And I guess the duplication factor doesn't make things easy.
Oh, yeah, not at all.
Fin Fang Foom, I would agree that he's not as much of a psychic presence. Only barely, you know, these were very close results. Let's not forget that. I think that should count for something, like a win. For me?
No.
No?
No.
Okay.
Mind over matter, my friend. And Fin Fang Foom brought the matter to a mind fight. Starro got the win.
I mean, at the end of the day, at least Marvel fans can rest easy knowing that there's more of us in the world out there than DC fans. And if it came down to it, we could all gather up and just beat the shit out of all the DC fans.
You don't know that.
Oh, I know that. I'm pretty sure about that. Ugh. Take pride in that, Marvel fans.
What a mob asshole thing to say.
But I think that does it for this duel. Let us know what you thought about the results by writing to us at dynamicduelpodcast@gmail.com or by visiting us on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter. You can find links to all of our accounts by checking out our show notes or visiting our website, dynamicduel.com. And you should visit our website, dynamicduel.com/Batman, to visit cufflinks.com's fine selection of Batman fashion gear. Let us know what you think is the best one by using the product page's Twitter share button, being sure to @cufflinks.com and @dynamic_duel. If you do that, you're in the running to win a free Batman tie. Again, you have until this Saturday, September 18th, to do so.
And you have until the end of the month to use the promo code DUEL at cufflinks.com's checkout to get 15% off any order. That's a good deal. In our next episode, in lead up to Marvel's Eternals film that they'll be releasing in November, we are doing a Eternals-related duel when we pit Firestorm against Cersei.
Right, they can both transmute matter, they're both extremely powerful characters. Firestorm is definitely a top-tier DC hero, and it's going to be really fun to talk about Eternals on this show. If you don't know who Cersei is, she's going to be one of the leading characters in the upcoming Eternals movie. So,
yeah, Kevin Feige says that she's the main protagonist of that film.
Yeah, so look forward to that. It's going to be a great episode. But that does it for this episode. We want to give a big thanks to our executive producers, John Spies, Ken Johnson, Jace Crump, John Starosky, Zachary Hepburn, John Becinina, Mitchell Phipps, Dustin Balcom, and Salvador Hernandez Contreras Jr. for helping make this podcast possible. And we'll talk to you guys next week.
Up, up, and away,
true believers.